everyone. Call this meeting to order of the City of Montpelier Development Review Board. My name is Daniel Richardson. I am the vice chair, acting as the chair this evening. The other board members from my right are
Kevin O'Connell,
Meredith Crandall, staff,
Kate McCarthy,
Ryan Kane,
Will Shabow.
And we have to identify the five voting members. That is easy this evening. It is all five of us who will be voting on the applications tonight.
I will be accusing myself from number 9, 184 Elm Street, but not this evening.
That is pretty obvious, given that you are the applicant. But that will still preserve the quorum that we have. Just for those inquiring, we are still working under, I think this may be the last meeting, depending on how fast the governor acts, under the current charter that requires 5 members of the DRB, even though we have 7. It's a charter change that has gone through the legislature that will push our numbers back up to the full 7 that we used to enjoy. But at the beginning of every meeting, we try and identify which 5 we're going to be voting on a particular application. Next item of business is approval of the agenda. Do I have a motion to approve the agenda as printed, or a suggestion for an addition or change?
Mr. Chair, I move we approve the agenda as printed.
A motion to approve by Kate. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Kevin. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of the agenda as printed, raise your right hand. We have an agenda. The only comments from the chair is just a warm welcome to our new zoning administrator, Meredith, who this is your first meeting chairing the, staffing the meeting.
Thank you very much.
So, welcome.
Happy to be here.
Good. The May 7th minutes cannot be approved because we lack a quorum, so we'll move straight into 170 Spring Hollow Lane, our first application for the evening, which is a final plan review for a 2-lot subdivision. This plan did come before us before as a sketch plan review. Don set up, I'll swear both of you in to give testimony.
Kevin, can you see that?
Yes, I can. Plus, it's the same as what we have here, I believe.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
And if you'll state your names for the record.
Richard Rubin and Don Marsh.
Okay, if you raise your right hand, I'll swear you in. Do you solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give for the matter under consideration shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth under a pain of penalties of perjury?
Yes.
Very much. So, Don, you want to walk us through any changes from last time?
Yes, it's a 2-lot subdivision. Both lots are approximately 2 acres. The only real change is we've brought the building envelope back to avoid all the areas greater than 30% slopes. And in discussion with both the applicant and DPW, we decided to widen. We had originally a 20-foot wide finger that goes out to Spring Hollow Lane, and we bumped that up to 25. And we've had discussions with DPW, and so we've added some notes that reflect their comments. We've reduced actually the driveway to a 12-foot driveway, which they felt was fine. We've noted the location of some water infrastructure that will have to be relocated as part of the drive work, and we've noted that we'll put a surface water diversion swale on the upslope side of the row, the driveway, and then that flow will go around Spring Hollow Lane and then go generally northward to a cross culvert under Spring Hollow. And DPW wants us to be able to clean out their ditch so that it flows properly, unless they get to it first, but it does. And that's where the flow wants to go, but the ditch is sort of filled in as they do over time. I believe we've added the neighbor's house that wasn't on the sketch plan. That was a request of the board. But that's, we've added just a construction detail for the driveway.
Okay. And we talked, I think, one of the things before, I think now with the 12-foot driveway with 25-foot wide right-of-way, snow would just go off, shed off to either side.
And actually, it's not a right-of-way, it's actually the lot, yep.
One question I had, and this is going back and refreshing my memory from last time. Is this the only lot on that circle or this street that's likely to have this long, narrow tongue of land? Or are there other similarly situated lots of this nature?
There are a number of lots in the Grandfield, I'm not sure if it's Terrace, but if you go up through here, these lots, for instance,
yep.
There are five or six lots that were part of that, I think, in 1939, and then again 1973 subdivision, five rather. And various owners here on Spring Hollow have purchased those. So there are similar situations. And then, and it goes almost up to Sean Schuldeis's property at 178 Grandview Terrace. She's the last one on the left as you come down that part of Grandview Terrace. So those lots start behind the houses along Spring Hollow Lane. Those old lots that were acquired and generally are part of existing lots along Spring Hollow.
There's a possibility down the road there'd be other of these sort of subdivisions where...
I think it's possible, yes.
Right. I'm just, one of the things we have to review later on is the character of the neighborhood and looking, just curious if this is, I mean, I think this is consistent, it's a residential development within a residential neighborhood, but just wondering if it would, is this sort of an anomaly, or is this the first in a series of these type of sort of back lane developments or backfield developments?
Which answer helps our case?
Mr. Chair, we did, I'd rather hear from the applicant.
The other lots are smaller than this lot. The one immediately next to Kitchens is very steep. So it's not likely to be suitable like this one is, because this one opens up. And I think maybe there's two lots up above, not five or six, I'm familiar with the survey. Could happen. Because once you get up a little higher, the access is then from the backside from Westview rather than from Spring Hollow.
My understanding was that Westview hadn't been put in and developed.
That's correct.
Right.
The right-of-way appears on the old plat, but it was never built.
But unless somebody actually put that in, they would still have to have creation of additional flag lots like this to be able to get to a current road of some sort, right?
Only for two of them, because up once you go further up towards
Grandview,
then you actually come to Grandview, so then you could access off of Grandview.
So where does this, I'm just a little confused as to exactly where the location is. I know where Grandview Terrace is, and that's kind of horseshoe, that horseshoe configuration to Town Hill Road. So where does Spring Hollow Lane?
Get to the bottom of Grandview.
Bottom, which bottom? I mean, there's two bottoms.
Well, the very bottom, let's say we're starting
up the hill?
Up the hill on the eastern edge of Grandview.
Right.
You come down, and just as you start to turn along that bottom loop, Spring Hollow drops off to the left. So it goes straight down from the bottom of Grandview.
Okay, I'm with you. Yep, I've got it located
in
my mind now. Yep.
Three or four houses on the left there?
Yes. Yep.
So before you get to the cul-de-sac.
Right.
Then there's a little cul-de-sac at the bottom of Spring Hollow with three houses on it.
So there would be no flag lots, so to speak, off of that little circle at the bottom.
Because Grandview is all pretty much developed, right?
Yeah.
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Still trying to piece it together in my mind, but I think I'm getting there.
Mr. Chair, responding to your earlier comment about sort of the unique situation with the lots behind the lots that had been acquired over the years, I had the same question the last time we looked at this, and I think think where we landed as a group is that it's an interesting question. It could happen, but we are without means to evaluate those impacts, given that they have not been proposed. But it does raise that question of how do we measure and understand incremental changes to the character of the neighborhood, and what is the proverbial straw that breaks the camel's back of character. So excellent, good question. I have the same one. I don't have an answer though.
Yeah. I think it's just helpful to understand, and looking at the last map in our packet, I noticed that it looks like Sean Schuldeis Banfield has, or second to last, looks like she has title to large majority of the back behind the proposed lot here, but then it looks like there's the Stones and the Smiths have these sort of hammer head lots that possibly could down the line. At the same time, I mean, at least my initial, and I don't want to speak for the rest of them, I'm only one member, but this is developing a large residential tract of land. The one oddity about it is this flag post or tongue of land that uses it to connect to the public right-of-way. But it also doesn't look like there are, I mean, it looks like there's a possibility that going forward there could be more of these, but it also doesn't look all that inconsistent. I mean, this is a cul-de-sac. Not going to have an impact on through traffic. It's not uncommon to have these kind of spokes off of this type of wheel. So that
I would just say, I think it's very clear that the ordinance anticipated that, and it does have the provision that doesn't seems to allow it without it. I mean, it needs your approval. But it doesn't sound like it's a conditional approval. I mean, it reads fairly straightforward.
Right, and that actually brings us to next. I think under general standard, and this is RES 24 frontage requires 75 feet to 25 feet of frontage. Now you've bumped it up to 25 feet. It meets the minimum, but we have to approve the reduction. Does anyone have any problem with that, or want to explore any particular questions in regards to this?
Not really. I mean, is there a reason why you couldn't have a? I appreciate that, and I wasn't here for the sketch plan, so I think it's probably appreciated that it went from 20 to 25. Is there a reason it couldn't be wider? Is it setbacks to the house? Is it because it's unnecessary? Is it?
It could physically be. I mean, we have 65 feet remaining, and the side yard setback is what I think only 15. But they're big lots, and it wouldn't seem to make sense to crowd it up to make it. I don't know that it accomplishes anything by making any more. I mean, you could do 30 or 40 feet or 50 even, but I'm not sure it adds anything because people aren't going to use that as a frontage or a lawn or anything. I mean, it makes sense that it's a drive out to a secluded lot.
Yeah. I guess my understanding of this cul-de-sac is fairly wooded down there, correct?
Yes, the land both through which this tongue, if you will, goes through is all wooded, and the parcel itself is all wooded.
Yeah, so I mean, I think, as you said, if you could increase that tongue to 50 feet, you know, you're still not going to put a 50-foot wide swath clear cut in there. You're going to probably just a minimal amount to get the road in and the necessary utilities and whatnot. So.
Exactly. It wouldn't make. Yeah. I mean, the attraction of this lot, I mean, one is it's large, it's nearly 2.5 times the requirement. But it's a nice secluded lot. It can, with some opening up, you can get a view and some solar exposure. But it's not a, it's clearly not intended to be sort of an on-street lot.
And as you noted, you've moved the building envelope away from the slopes that are unlikely to be buildable. Obviously, the act of subdivision itself doesn't disturb soils or interact with slopes, but I think the map that you've driven, the revised map that you've submitted, touches upon those areas, and obviously that's a limitation in any development down the road. But given that, it appears that your building envelope is more than sufficient for a building or two or three. So, I think just looking at this, are there any other questions from the board?
This pertains to something on pages 7 and 8 of the staff report, and it has to do with the distance between Nishiachi's driveway and the proposed driveway. And I was wondering if you had that measurement between the two driveways. It's been estimated by staff at 50 feet, which I think would exceed the 45-foot minimum requirement. But do you have an actual number?
Between the neighbor down below?
Yep. I've got it on another diagram.
I think...
Survey, I guess.
I know they said that it was 45, but I think it's, frankly, it's... I want to say it's... If you bear with me... I think it's closer to 10 or 15 feet. Because it's... Let me look at this. Yeah, see, I mean, we're here. No, it's right. I mean, this is 20. This was 20. He measured those 20. So. Yeah. I think the driveways are going to be more 30 or 35 feet apart.
30 to 35 feet.
Yeah, I don't think we'll meet the 45.
Okay.
Just because this is the, we think this is a, part of it, it puts it next to the lot line, which makes sense from a, not going through the middle of the existing Amanda's house. The other is it follows an old wood road, so it's partially cleared. Mm-hmm. So the clearing is minimized by that.
There's also a line of trees between the Nishiaki house to the left of their driveway that will provide a visual barrier. So it's not like the driveway will be right in their front yard. There's a barrier, there's a buffer there of trees already.
May I just clarify something in the report? So there at the bottom of page 7, we couldn't estimate exactly what the distance was between the two, the current driveway and the proposed. So what we tried to estimate was the distance between the Nishiachi driveway and the far side of the actual extension, the flagpole, because we couldn't quite tell based on the lines where things were going to be at that point. But I also, my understanding is that when Tom McArdle went to take a look at the plans and speak to the engineer, that he didn't have any more concerns with that distance, the separation. And so our concerns were mostly, staff's concerns were mostly dealt with, but we definitely wanted to flag it for you to discuss.
Okay. Any other questions for the applicant? So there's a proposal to put in a septic system on site?
Yes. I mean, that's the plan.
Okay. And has there been any testing for that yet?
No, we've looked at the soils maps and the slopes, and it looks like you can do an on-site system there, but we've not done the testing yet.
So would you accept a condition as to any permit approval that you would have first obtained, before any development, you'd have to obtain a permit from A&R for the septic system?
Absolutely.
There's a little but there.
Okay.
This
oh, oh, I'm
excuse me.
This ordinance doesn't require, as part of a subdivision, that we get the wastewater permit. And what the, so what our hope was that we could build a driveway this summer, and then decide whether to, how to market the lot, and then get the wastewater permit. So I didn't want to have a condition on the permit that precluded us doing any work, like the driveway.
That wouldn't preclude you from doing work on the driveway. I just...
That's fine. If that doesn't preclude that, then...
It's just my concern, you know, the act of subdivision is always trying to create a lot that can be accessed from the public right-of-way, but that's also self-sustaining, whether it be, you know, accessible to city sewer or parking for septic purposes. So, I mean, that would be my concern, is to put a condition on that would require at some point to obtain you or the successor.
I don't have any problem with that, as long as we can go ahead and build a driveway and then either sell a lot with an understanding that the buyer will get the permit, or we'll get it. Either way, we haven't figured that out.
Any problem with that?
If something prior to a zoning permit would be,
yeah,
would be fine, because that, or a building permit, so that,
right.
And that, we need that for that anyway. We need the WW permit for that.
Right.
I'm sorry, if the subdivision, if approval of the subdivision is not contingent upon the granting of a wastewater permit, and the zoning permit is, what do we get in the subdivision by adding it on here? Why would we note it here if it's going to be covered elsewhere? Because usually we would, in the interest of creating a buildable lot, we would make sure that the lot is buildable with something like a perk test. But what is our goal attaching it here?
Well, I mean, to a certain extent, and this is, and I may have overstated how willing and flexible the condition was. I mean, I think my concern, at least, is that it's one thing to build a driveway, but it's another to either sell the lot or, you know, spin it off from the other lot if we don't know if it can obtain a wastewater permit. You know, understanding that if you do build the driveway, you do sell it, it doesn't have a wastewater permit. It's now in the hands of a third party, and if it proves to lack any type of perkability for whatever reason. But I guess that would make it a mound system at that point. My concern is leaving a lot without any developable nature.
Yeah. Mr. Chair, So section 3506C, water and wastewater facilities, this is under the subdivision regulations. The applicant shall design the subdivision to provide potable water and wastewater facilities according to the following, and then number three, any subdivision not within the city's water or sewer service area shall demonstrate compliance with the state's wastewater system and potable water supply rules. That demonstration of compliance would be by obtaining a wastewater potable water supply permit from ANR. So I do think it is something that is a requirement for approval of the subdivision to demonstrate that you can have on-site wastewater disposal if you're not served by the city's municipal sewer system. And I share the same concerns you were just having. I think it would be unwise to approve it, say that you can go forward, have it be a legally separate lot, build a driveway, and then if it turns out that everybody's wrong and it's not possible to put an on-site wastewater system to then have this, you know, lot with a driveway there that's not actually developable and arguably should not have obtained a subdivision approval.
We're not looking for an actual installed septic system, but I think the assurance necessary.
Okay, it probably makes sense before we spent the money on the driveway to make sure that the land would perk or would have a wastewater system. I don't have a problem with that.
I think from a marketability standpoint, yeah, people like looking for land that's already got at least the wastewater permit.
Yeah. I was actually going to back off of that a little bit. Based on what Ryan read, the requirement is that the applicant demonstrate compliance with the state's wastewater system and potable water supply rules, which I think is that is, I believe that is different than obtaining a permit. That shows that you are able to eventually obtain a permit based on site conditions. So that's my interpretation. I'm open to discussing that, but I don't see that as saying you need to get a permit before you can have this subdivision.
Yeah.
Are there other ways to demonstrate compliance? That might be a question for Don.
We prefer it as a condition. The other way would be to do the soils testing sufficient that, you know, I could write a letter saying that it'll would get a permit. We've done that in some projects. It's just a monetary chicken and the egg. I mean, it's cost enough to go through the subdivision process that you'd like to. If you get through that, then it's worth spending the money to go ahead and do the site testing and design. So if for some reason, I mean, for instance, the flag lot issue, if that were to be a fundamental problem with the, we hope it's not, but if that were a fundamental problem with the board, then it would have been a waste to spend several thousand dollars to do the testing. So we would prefer to have it a condition of the approval that you obtain agency, natural resource, water, wastewater permit prior to any development. And if development is termed as construction or acquisition of or submittal for a zoning permit or building permit.
I don't necessarily. I mean, I think we have to back it up further, and maybe that. I mean, it's one thing, I guess, to submit a letter. Although it sounds like you're comfortable with getting either a permit or a design in place.
Yeah, I guess I ought to do that, and that's I don't have a problem with that. Just my goal is to kind of get the driveway going, you know, before it's. And but I don't know how long it takes to get apply for to get the wastewater permit moving.
I mean, I have no problem crafting a condition about the wastewater permit that doesn't preclude you from doing starting the driveway.
That'd be fine.
It's just that I think before any sale of the property or any, you know, moving beyond finalizing the subdivision, there has to be something that we can rely upon, that this is a self-sustaining lot with its ability to have its own septic system. And I think that's a fairly low bar given how sophisticated septic systems can be in almost wet areas. You know, they can, with the mound system, you're creating that.
Most these days, the rules are such that most sites, not all, but most can support on-site wastewater disposal.
Right. So, I mean, I don't think it's either an onerous burden or one that would be unfair to put.
But perhaps unnecessary. I mean, the question I've been asking myself as I've been listening to the discussion is, why would we build into the approval process steps that are not specifically there for us to consider? If we're just doing a subdivision at this point, it's up to the owner and the applicant at some future time to cross that river.
Mm-hmm. I do believe that is one of the standards we need to demonstrate compliance with. The one that Ryan read is 3506.
C.
C.
Yeah. Mike? So Mike Miller, the planning director. So I just wanted to go and say there isn't, just for you to keep in mind, all the plats have to be signed, so you do have a window whereby you could go and say, approve with a condition that prior to the plat being recorded, X has to happen.
Right.
And that would, so you do have a window of opportunity to go and kind of get in between, where the concern is we don't want to invest money unless we know it's going to get approved.
Right.
And approving it. So there actually is a signing period for that and then that's actually the window I was thinking of.
Mm-hmm.
Would be the right window, and that way.
Still stuck in the
line. You know,
that's a 180-day window after the approval.
So I think that's a reasonable time window. That wouldn't preclude you from working on the driveway. It wouldn't work. It's just finalizing the subdivision. I think it's necessary only because, you know, if we do approve a subdivision and leave it, that it can't be perked, even though most lots can have some septic system. Yes.
I was going to say, just in terms of the difference between the compliance and actually having, you know, the lot can be compliant with the wastewater permit, but versus actually having it, you know, in terms of the specific design. You know, so like you said, you could write a letter saying that, yes, we can put a septic system here. We don't know how big it's going to be for, like, a one-bedroom house or a four-bedroom house or a seven-bedroom house, you know, and specifically where, based on where the house could go in the building envelope. You know, there's, you know, I see the conundrum of, like, how specific do we want to get with saying what you have to do, because, you know, the house is whoever buys it wants to put the house way in the northeast corner. But, you know, you've already applied for the wastewater permit and had it, you know, specifically designed where the septic system is in somewhere else, you know, hypothetical. So I guess I'd almost move to thinking about just like the proving and having the knowledge that, yes, a wastewater system can be designed and fit in here, but not necessarily having an actual wastewater permit.
I'm fine with that. I think that makes sense to me as well. And again, I mean, I think there's a question as to what sort of burden, you know, whether just, if Don, I think if you've been a little more sure in an initial letter, like, you know, that this would definitely perk, then that would probably be enough to satisfy our standards. But on anything like that, it sounds like there's at least some chance that it wouldn't.
I think what's important is that if Don wrote this letter and signed it, he'd have his professional license behind it. It's more than just simply, if I was to sign it, he'd say, I'm sure it will work. It has to work. Which might be more faith-based engineering. I'm comfortable with that too.
Sure.
Okay.
Just want to understand exactly what the condition will be. But that's fine. I just like to know.
So when
we submit something, it's clear that we've met what you want.
Sure. What I'm envisioning, and from our discussion here, and I'll make it clear, is that that we would add a condition at our approval that prior to the finalizing of the plat, 180 days out from granting of the permit, Don would have to submit a letter saying that this lot would support a septic system of such a capacity, either a one bedroom house or two, you know, four bedroom house, you know, some capacity, based on his professional opinion, review of the site, review of the soils, whatever he relies upon as a professional engineer to make that opinion. I think that will be sufficient rather than requiring you to design an entire septic system, not knowing what type of building you're going to, or the successor is going, the owner is going to build. So that way, at least we have an opinion on record that it supports some structure, and that would have to be required after approval, but before it became finalized.
Thank you.
Okay. I think you've already represented that you're planning on designing the driveway to meet the B71 standard.
Yes.
There was a question about the sufficient clearing of vegetation and possibly either working with the tree warden in some of the staff comments. Have you had a chance to look at
those? I belatedly tried to reach him, and he snuck off to North Carolina, so I've missed him. We have no problem with talking to Jeff prior to starting work on the driveway.
Okay.
And one of the other reasons we moved the 25-foot is that there's a mature maple tree that in this process we discovered is actually on the neighbor's land, but the pin is about a foot from the tree, so the further we push it away, we'll protect that tree some. And John Snell gave us some suggestions, and they were repeated in the staff comments about how we treat any roots that, and we, no matter, you know, within 20 feet, you're still going to hit roots, so how you treat those during construction.
And then in the driveway construction, do you have any issue with incorporating, you know, the proper drainage control? Because obviously you're changing some of the slopes and the way water flows across because you're creating the driveway.
Well, what we agreed to with DPW is to have essentially a upslope road ditch that'll take, there's not much drainage above it. There's only a little bit of land on Amanda's lot that will drain that way, and it's through the woods, so, and some lawn. It's not going to be significant, but that road ditch will lead down to Spring Hollow Lane and then around the cul-de-sac and then north to an existing city culvert.
The proposal is to tie all that in together. Is that going to be open culvert?
It'll be open swale until Amanda's driveway, and then she has a culvert, and then it's an open swale to a very short one to the city culvert.
Okay, so really it's creating that new open swale to connect to her driveway because the rest, yes, of that's already existing?
Well, it's existing, but it's just filled in. So it's to maintain that, to clean that out, so that goes back to what it was when it was really constructed, okay, originally constructed.
Okay, so if one of the conditions is to maintain that new culvert system, part of the construction.
It's not it's the existing system.
Sorry, the existing, but I understand.
Just to clean the ditch out.
To clean it out as part of the installation process.
Right, but not, we'd like it not to be a long-term.
Yeah, no,
it's
no,
a
I'm
city
sorry.
Ditch.
I thought you said maintain, but I may have misheard. We're talking about just the construction process to,
exactly,
clean it out, to reestablish.
Reestablish it would be a good.
Does anybody have any other questions, or what's the pleasure of the board?
I'll make a motion that we approve. What's the number here? Application Z 2018-0039, two-lot subdivision, as presented, with the condition that prior to signing the final plat, the applicant shall submit to the Planning and Zoning Department a letter or other document demonstrating the ability to comply with the state wastewater and potable water supply rules, and as a further condition that the agreed upon suggestions by the Department of Public Works for the swale along the new driveway and the cleaning out of the existing drainage on the lot one be completed.
Motion by Ryan.
Second.
Second by Kevin. Further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. You have your two-lot subdivision.
Thank you.
Love it.
When do you leave? When do you leave tonight? Thursday morning. 20 minutes of your time tonight.
Sure.
Okay. And you got other stuff to do here?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll stick around with Bob just in case.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, next item up for business is 213 Main Street. Mr. Gowans?
Yes.
Can you state your name for the record?
Robert Gowans.
Okay, this is sketch plan review, so
yes,
we were not going to swear you in because we don't formally take testimony on a sketch plan, but the purpose is really to give you an opportunity to present your proposal for us to ask questions and discuss and see if there are any issues. Take comment from any of the public that wish to comment on this initial sketch plan review. That gives you an opportunity to go back, maybe either redesign or add things that are missing or make alterations, and then come back for the final review. So why don't you give us an overview of what you're proposing?
Okay, so proposing a two-lot subdivision. The current lot at 213 Main Street is it's The current square footage is 17,400 square feet, or about a half acre. Proposing to divide it into two lots. The lot one, which is where my current house is now, would be 10,042 square feet, and lot two, the proposed lot, second lot, would be 7,380 approximately square feet. Not proposing an additional curb cut. Proposal is to expand the current driveway curb cut, and that's Public Works prefers to do that, to, instead of putting in a second one, just to expand that. So that's currently where we're at.
So how will the driveway come into the, when you say expand, do you mean expand across the front of the?
Yes, by approximately 12 feet. The driveway there now would go uphill approximately 12 more feet, expand the curb cut. Public Works, and I looked at it, would have to do a little bit of redesign on the sidewalk there.
Right.
And so ultimately, in the end, there would be a small right-of-way because the beginning of that driveway would cross lot one before it enters into lot two. A small section of it, yeah.
That's what I was curious about. So,
yeah.
So on lot one, there would be a little bit of an entrance.
The current property now has 154 feet of frontage on Main Street. Proposed lot two would be 55 feet. So proposed lot two would have 55 feet of frontage on Main Street.
It would certainly be helpful in any final to have that proposed driveway, just to illustrate how far into the lot two it's going to go, and to understand the traffic flow. I mean, I think I understand, having a shared driveway myself on Main Street, what you're talking about, but it would be helpful just to see it illustrated.
To draw it out so you can have it. Okay.
And yep. And to see how wide of a driveway we're visually talking about. I think that's helpful.
Also on your lot two, I think I've got this right, you mentioned that it was 55 feet in width, and yet the plan says 65.
That's an old, I think the one that got submitted was, that was by Hinge Architect. Yeah, that's not.
Yeah.
Do you have a new one?
We have the Grenier one.
Yeah.
Oh.
We have one by Grenier.
Okay, I see.
Right.
Yep, so yeah, this one has 55 feet.
Right, the one that was done by Don Marsh.
Yep.
Should, and I think that one said 55.
Yeah, I mean.
So it is 55, yes. What you were looking at actually happened before Meredith came on board, so there was a little shuffle there. So that's
so
how
this is obsolete.
Yes.
Except that it does show where the current driveway is, which helps.
Right. But this, because this shows what looks like almost like a 25-foot front yard setback, which is no longer. Setback is now 10 feet.
25 of the current house.
Right. I mean, I'm looking at residential 3,000.
Right.
Setbacks for the front.
Right. Or 10.
10 foot setbacks.
Yep.
But just on the old Hine or Hinge draft, it looks like it's illustrating a 25.
Right. Because that was before the current zoning.
Right.
We weren't. Prior to the current zoning, we were not residential 3,000.
If you take a look at the first Hinge drawing,
yep.
The A10, it actually has a 10-foot front setback showing.
Right.
We started it in the old zoning and prior to Meredith. And
right. It, that would be another point that would be helpful, is to see the building envelope of the new lot with all this, with both the setbacks, and I noticed that in the map that Don has provided, there's the steep slopes.
Yeah.
So obviously.
And those are right here.
Right.
Here, yeah.
But that's gonna limit your building envelope.
Yes.
A bit. You're obviously not gonna be able to build on that steep slope.
Correct.
But then also it looks like it falls the back portion of lot two. develop, because there's no way to get there. Like, you couldn't put a building back there, could you?
We have no intentions of doing that, but actually there would be.
Maybe like a shed or something.
Well, actually, I do have a right-of-way that comes in off from Harrison Avenue, which would be to the left of 22 Harrison Avenue. I do have a right-of-way there that's still in the remains current in the town records. That was from a number of years ago. There was the current house had a garage underneath it that you accessed from a driveway that came in off from Harrison Avenue. But the short answer to your question is, I have no intentions of doing anything down there. Anything that would be done would be up on the level lot at Main Street.
Right, and it would just be helpful to see the building envelope with the setbacks and the slopes. Given, not that you have to design or put a house there, but just to show us where a house could be
situated. Where would go, okay. Because there currently is no plan for...
Right, and most subdivisions aren't, like the last one.
Right.
Didn't have a plan, but
so
they showed...
Where it would fit on there. Got it.
And part of that is so that we know that there are spaces on here that would meet the setbacks and still allow development in creating this lot.
Okay.
And then this would be served by city water and sewer?
Yes, it would.
Which your current house is as well?
Yes.
The shed that's depicted on...
On current proposed lot two?
Yeah.
It's going to be removed.
Okay.
Yep.
I kind of figured.
Yeah, it would be removed. I was hoping to have it removed by now, but...
Shed.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's going to be removed.
When you say removed, are you just demolishing it?
Yes, removed, yeah.
Not picking it up?
No, removed. There's a, you can see there's another storage shed behind the house on proposed lot one.
Right.
Yeah.
Meredith, were there any questions that occurred to you?
Other than what we've dealt with, I think the only other issue was just to make sure that for the final review application, there are comments addressing the subdivision standards, sections 3502, 3, 06, and 07.
Capacity of the lot?
I don't at this point. Yeah.
I mean, it's a fairly treeless area. So.
Yeah, there's actually no trees on the proposed lot two. Just there's lilac bushes that would remain. I have no intentions of removing those. But there's no trees on the proposed lot two.
So, I mean, it would be possible to install solar panels on it. Solar shed or some kind.
It's an ideal
just
spot.
Just to orient the building toward the south with big windows, it would also be allowed, and that's one of the things we look to here in the new standards.
It's an ideal solar location. My current house has solar on it.
And would a construction of the house affect your solar panels?
No.
There's enough distance between the two of them?
Yes.
Is anybody here to be heard on this application? the sketch plan? Okay. Yeah, I think a lot of the city services are somewhat self-evident on 3502. I mean, the ambulance, the fire, police, it's right there on the curb. This is an infill lot in a high-density area. So that's essentially what you're creating, is you're taking that spare lot next to your house and turning it into additional housing.
Correct.
Any other questions? So I think, has DPW had any input on this?
Yes, they did, and nothing really controversial. Just that new connections will need to be properly designed before they get their permits.
And you did say that you spoke with DPW about the driveway.
Yeah, just about the driveway.
No. Okay.
Yeah, and that's, I know that Tom has several comments about that, but.
Yeah.
That's what they prefer, is to do it that way and not a second curb cut.
That's easier. Yeah, I think that's more straightforward and adheres to the zoning ordinance better, too. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not seeing any red flags come up as far as any issues that would be either non-starters or concerns. As far as the bylaws are concerned, they seem to, there's room to put a house on this under the bylaws as they exist. It's just, it will be nice next time around just to have some of that,
yes,
the driveway and the building envelope flushed out to understand how that works.
Yeah, we'll have a plan with that on it. Yeah.
Good. Any other questions, comments from the board? Well, I think that's all we can do for you tonight.
All right, well, thank you.
You're good.
Thank you.
Looks good. And we'll see you back here soon.
It's 2 weeks. Is that what it is, ma'am?
You'll need to do a new application.
Okay.
When you,
I'll talk to you tomorrow.
Yeah, that sounds great. Come on down.
Okay, I'll see you tomorrow.
Okay. The next application the applicant has asked that it be pulled. That would be the Murray Hill application. And is that they revoked it or have
they've withdrawn it. They provided an official letter to withdraw it, and
okay,
they will work with the planning department to do a new application.
To fully withdraw, not they've, just to...
They didn't just table it.
They
didn't just table it. They fully withdrew it and notified all of the abutters before they even told us. So we couldn't convince them to table it.
That doesn't require any action on our part.
Nope.
Just simply if anybody was here for that. So the next item is 184 Elm Street. And Meredith, you're switching with Mike.
Yes. I'm going to step down as staff for a moment.
I'll be excusing myself.
Yes.
Hello.
So if you'll state your names for the record, and then I'll swear you in.
I'm Will Schaebaum.
Zachary Hunter.
Okay, if you'll raise your right hand, you solemnly swear or affirm that the evidence you're about to give for the matter under consideration shall be the truth and nothing but the truth under the pains and penalties of perjury.
I do.
Good. All right, Mr. Schaebaum, take us through what you're proposing.
Well, the proposal for 184 Elm Street is to convert a, for the most part, unused carriage barn attached to the main four-unit property into more living space by adding two more units and corresponding parking, and in the process having to remove a portion of the carriage barn, which is at one point probably an addition. It's kind of a crumbling, falling down shed.
And this is not, is this the same property we reviewed a couple of years ago? Or is this
there was a sketch plan last fall.
And we went through.
I wasn't part of it at that point.
Okay, so that's where my confusion is from, because I was remembering that this looked awful familiar.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. More of a feasibility at that point, my understanding, kind of like testing the waters.
Previously, it was
under the old zoning rules, if you had more than four units, you fell under planned unit development, and you therefore had to go through the three-step process. So they had gone through the first step of the three-step process, and then the zoning changed.
So now you're back with the same project?
Same project,
same project with new rules.
That was part of the delay, was, you know, talking to Sarah back in November, and she's like, you might want to just wait. So otherwise, we might have to go through two reviews on two different zoning ordinances.
Right. Or at least presumably get in under the old one, but so.
Chair, or maybe Mike, so the application is stated to be site plan conditional and demolition of contributing structure. Do we have to do preliminary? Preliminary approval, or do we jump right into it with the new ordinance?
I think you jump right into it. There isn't a preliminary under the new rules. It's a one-step process unless it's a subdivision. Subdivisions are the only two-step. This project is not a subdivision.
No longer a subdivision.
It's no longer a subdivision. Correct.
Okay.
Well, maybe you can take us step by step, and I just like a refresher, just because I am going to mix this up in my head. What we did last year. So, what's there now?
There is four units, mental, commercial property.
Right.
Two units in the main house, and it's kind of an L coming off into the two apartments. And then there's this carriage barn, which is, people can store trash, there's...
Uninhabited,
yeah, pigeons. Some structural foundation issues, and there's a shed portion coming off the back of that, which is the proposed section we're going to remove, and that's kind of the location of the new parking. And then there's another detached carriage barn behind that, which is not part of this application, that is also storage.
Okay, So essentially, you have the main house with two units in it, and you have two apartments behind it.
Which is attached to the main house.
Which is attached to the main house. And then attached to that last of the four units is the unused sort of carriage barn.
Yeah.
And then there's like a connector.
Well, it's not really a connector shed. If you look on page A03, there you'll see sort of the north facade. There's a porch, and then there's the main gable, and then there's the long photograph portion, and then you can see the carriage barn attached to that. So the shed that we're proposing to remove is on the tail end of that, on the back side. Mm-hmm. So, to the far western end.
Okay.
It's the fourth segment of this rather long, classic.
This caterpillar.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. It just kind of keeps going.
Okay, so it's just the shed section that's attached to the, we were calling it carriage barn.
Yeah.
Presumably it.
Yeah, I think the site plan shows it, as well. You can see sort of like this, just as you said, the caterpillar that keeps going.
Right. And then beyond the shed, there's a space.
Yep.
And then there's another barn.
Yep.
It's not part of this application. Another day, another home improvement.
Yeah.
And then going to A5 then is what you're proposing, or sort of these drawings of this,
Yeah, so sort of in the space of where that connector shed, well, not the connector shed, but the what we're proposing to remove is going to be, some parking and the exterior staircase access for the two new apartments.
Okay. And that will be the primary point of access for the two apartments?
Yes. Yeah.
Will be these staircases that are in back?
Yep.
And will these two parking spaces be for these new apartments?
Yeah.
And is this just the drawing, or is it going to have this sort of...
That's just the conceptual staircase right now. It's probably going to be, code compliant. foundation concrete piers.
I presume that was going to be cool.
Yeah, we haven't.
Floating stairs. Yeah.
Cantilevered glass railings.
Okay, and these are one bedroom apartments.
Right? Yeah, they're essentially studios.
That orients me to what's being proposed. One of the issues last time around was parking.
Mm-hmm.
And if I remember correctly, you have a parking arrangement with 182 that
it's
okay. Remember, there was a reconfiguration of that parking. Is that still being proposed, or do the two new parking spaces take care of that, or how does the parking look today, and how is it going to look tomorrow?
I believe you've been in correspondence with Greg.
A little bit. I'm sure
you have the most current. Yeah, so you have the copy of the original agreement that's recorded in the records, which has, it's basically all parallel parking. On your property on 182, and then there used to be a parking spot on 184, but that has been removed to allow the access to the rear spots. So I think the agreement that Mr. Guyette, the hunters are working out is to rewrite the agreement. Correct me if I'm wrong.
You would have to do that.
Yeah. So that basically they can have, because currently it stands is that 184 has three parking spots on your property.
Yes.
Well, we have two.
You have two.
And then we actually allow 184 to park. But they're all really parked on our property, actually. They all have to go over their property, but
yeah.
This is our property right along here. So currently they're all parked along our property. And they would be, I think, under this agreement too, with the exception.
Yeah, but I think the change is adding one spot to the.
Right. Right. So there will be two spots behind, and the one spot will be added to the.
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess they could all fit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think it's all been figured out.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's something we're going to need to. Mm-hmm. I'm looking at this. Proposed site plan, so it looks as if what are the parking requirements for this district? The parking requirements are one per dwelling unit, so they would need to have six for 184, right? And so your proposal is five, right?
Well, it would, with the new agreement, it would be for six. There would be four spots on 182 for the 184 plus the two new ones.
Okay, so right now you have.
I think the mix.
You have five spaces, five parking spaces. Is that right?
I think the mix up is that in the. Because I sort of came to this project after the sketch plan from previously, and it had already been drawn as like, here's the existing, and I wasn't aware of the agreement that was written up, which has three parking spots for 184 plus two parking spots for 182 on 182's property. But with the proposed site plan, there would be four parking spots on 182 for 184, and then two for 182, and then the two new ones we're putting on 184.
For a total of six. Okay, so the three parallel spots and then one of the angled spots.
Yes. Yep.
And two mm-hmm. new spots between. Yeah.
Where the old shed was.
The old shed.
The agreement that's written up is for three parallel spots for 184 and then two parallel spots for 182.
So basically the proposed site plan complies to the zoning, but the current agreement that's recorded in the land records does not. So they just have to work out an amended agreement and then record an amended agreement and then everything will be matching.
And just so you know, this is an issue, and Ms. Hunter, since you're here as well, so that you know, if we were to grant that approval, that's just zoning approval. It still has to be worked out privately between the parties, which is, if you have private legal rights, it doesn't matter what the zoning permit says. It doesn't change the legal rights and responsibilities between the parties, and it sounds like you're working towards some type of workable agreement along those lines, but the zoning permit wouldn't change that, in other words. It would just simply say that if you do come up with six, you can build what you want. But of course, if you can't come up with six, then you can't build what you want. So it certainly puts a certain amount of pressure between the parties to work out the parking arrangement. But it sounds like you're working in that direction. But I just wanted to make clear, because sometimes people can get confused between the interplay between the zoning and the private agreements. But our permit won't, whether we issue a permit or not, won't change that. Okay. So go back to the beginning. Unless anybody has any other sort of free floating questions before we dive in. That the demolition is a threshold question that we have to address. Page 6.
Didn't we approve the demolition before? In which case, I wonder if we can make a bridge to that decision.
I don't know. If it was sketch, we may have just said we don't see a problem with it.
I guess the cleanest way is to just do it de novo.
Yeah. Okay, so I think for the record, if you can give me a little bit of information about the shed, does it have a foundation?
No. Not that I'm aware of. I mean, I think some of the pictures, as you can see on the demolition proposal page, show that it's kind of, it's essentially dirt underneath there, and it's sagging, indicating that there's no stone or anything really under there.
And is this, and just looking at the narrative, so the structure is listed on the National Register as contributing, but is this shed original to the barn itself?
I'm unaware of that, if it's original or not. I mean, I think the contributing element is because it's in the historic district.
Mm-hmm.
So my guess is that the shed was, I mean, it could have been original. I mean, it's hard to say whether, you know.
Well, I mean, just in your investigation, is this something where the barn itself has four walls and the shed sits?
Well, yes, it's true.
It's definitely extraneous. It was built after the fact. Whether that was 50 years ago or 80 years ago would be anybody's guess.
I suspect it was built a while ago.
There's clapboards on the inside of the shed. So that, I guess, a good testament that it was added on afterwards.
So, and any speculation as to what the purpose of this shed was?
My guess is some sort of livestock. There's definitely some like little hatches from the main carriage barn into like, there's kind of like a loft area in the shed. My guess is like hay storage or some element.
And is this something where the foundation is worn out or where there just never was a foundation?
I just don't think there was one.
So wasn't built with the same permanence as the main carriage structure.
Yeah.
something where the rotting of this shed, because it's attached to the building, is deteriorating the main building itself?
I wouldn't necessarily say it's contributing a whole lot to the deterioration of the carriage barn. I think one of the elements of the project is some substantial foundation repair, which, you know, with the shed being gone, it opens up the opportunity to really repair the carriage barn foundation in a proper manner, but, you know, this would be, you'd be removing a good portion of the carriage barn, or the shed, to repair, if you were to, say, put a foundation under the shed.
Right. I mean, that would be, what kind of expense would that be for the foundation under a shed where one had never existed?
It would be substantial. A couple, you know, upwards above $10,000.
$12,000 to $20,000.
Yeah. Right. You know, and it would make the repair of the carriage barn foundation more expensive.
And more difficult.
Exactly.
It would limit access for a doing a good job on the carriage barn, which is a more desirable structure to retain.
And it makes the, in terms of the site plan with the exterior stair access and the parking, makes that more
doable
as well.
So I'm thinking strictly from a demolition point of view, and part of the findings that we have to make is just to, you know, and I'll read it, that the demolition replacement of any structure portion thereof listed as contributing to structure to the Vermont Historic Sites and Structure Survey and the National Register of Historic Resources is prohibited unless the Development Review Board approves the demolition and site restoration plan, and the board finds that the demolition is part of a site development plan and design plan, if applicable, that would provide clear and substantial benefit to the community.
I think that's the sort of course we're trying to argue here, is that, you know, by, you know, removing this shed, we are therefore creating more housing that is essentially a clear and substantial benefit to the community.
Right. I mean, we just have to be careful because, of course, you know, if you have an old, you know, Italianate style house, it's very easy to raise it and put up a six-unit building.
That's true.
And that would be a community development, but that's not what this is intending to encourage. I would interpret it more along the lines of where we're going with some of this testimony, which is that what you're saying is that the essential part of this is a plan to rehab this barn, which has a need for a new foundation and repairs. Right now is empty and unoccupied, and really doesn't serve whatever use it once served, whether that be for farming or to store horses for carriages in town. It's not serving any function whatsoever. You're proposing to bring it back into use by creating residential structures out of it, right?
Yeah.
So, and that this shed, portion of the shed, one, doesn't really provide any benefit, because it's not as if you could make it into a bedroom, because it doesn't have a foundation.
Yeah.
To put a foundation on is an elaborate expense, which creates all kinds of other cascading costs, and it's not the main structure.
Yeah, I think it, obviously removing of it is not going to detract from the street face of the building and its historic character.
Any other questions about demolition? Are we satisfied?
I think it's pretty straightforward.
Okay. The driveway right now, if I remember correctly, it's hard packed.
I think it's crumbling pavement.
Crumbling pavement. is the plan to, what kind of surface are you going to
do? There's been discussion of paving, either repaving the existing and then paving some of the new. I think there's definitely some budgetary concerns, you know, whether it's going to be a permeable or impermeable surface. I think Mr. Guyette's long-term plan would be to have it be paved. So.
Okay.
But I know that, obviously, you know, the zoning regulations, like, you know, permeable surfaces, you know, in terms of absorbing rainwater and whatnot,
Well, I just, you know, from a stormwater management and erosion control perspective, trying to understand, if it's hard pack, that's a semi-impermeable surface.
Yeah.
Although this is a fairly minimal expansion. I mean, you're talking about ultimately keeping the driveway as it is, except for this addition where
You can sort of see it in these perspective photos. The site plan doesn't have the topography. It's for the most part flat, but there's a slight drop. You know, you're going to kind of go down to these two new parking spaces. So the two new areas that are created will be sort of in their own. They're below the main elevation of the main parking driveway area. So it's not like it's going to run off into the street or anything. And I think based on some of the landscaping plans that we're thinking about, you know, some sort of like, you know, rain garden or something in a way to deal with, you know, that little bit of runoff from the new site.
There's kind of a depression. I think it's Summer Street is the street that runs parallel behind Route 2. There's kind of a depression behind that house, and that's where where the parking comes down. It's probably 5 or 6 feet lower than the Main Street level parking, and then it drops probably even a little bit further as you come to the shared property lines with the properties on Summer Street.
And I noticed that the design calls for this that turnaround area, the little
nine. Yeah, like a little turnaround, so you can pull in and then back into the turnaround and then go out forwards.
Okay. And are there any, on 182, you know, which this essentially will be parking facing 182, are there windows on that side? Is there?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, is there any mitigating proposal?
Well, I mean, I think we propose, you know, landscaping to be installed around parking. We talk about, you know, cedar trees. There's already kind of a big hedge between, basically on the property line.
There's a large U hedge.
Yeah, this sort of U.
I think it looks like it's kind of tough to get the driveway.
I'm hoping we can keep those.
Well, they got
that's, the that's the plan, yeah.
No,
those
are on our property.
Yep.
It's a private street.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and I hope, like, we'd like, on the development of 184 to plant more. So that, you know, that parking area is, you know, screened more from your property.
Yeah, I think it's that people will pull in so the headlights won't.
Yeah, the headlights will be facing north.
Or upstairs.
Mm-hmm. So there'll be no direct headlights, in theory, shining at 182.
So, I mean, that it sounds like with the existing plantings, some of that is already mitigated, but you're proposing additional cedar hedges.
Yeah, I think, you know, there's some four new cedar trees, and we could always increase that as well. I mean, I think the four new ones was just to meet the requirements for the zoning regulations.
I don't understand exactly
what
it is. It looks like
there's one
this color.
I think.
So you have. That's the old one.
Oh, okay.
Definitely a tight area, but
well, I mean that's another issue is that, you know, this is we're adding another car to an already, and this was a concern that we raised last fall about the very tight driveway configuration. This almost requires balletic coordination between the different cars to make sure everybody gets in and out. I think we had taken testimony, but would just be helpful at this point in time about the existing. You already have five, or it almost looks like seven cars with 182 in that area going in and out. Would you characterize the way the traffic flows currently in the driveway?
The It seems to be, I mean, I think you have more of a...
You know the design.
Yeah, exactly. That's the thing is, you know, there's the design of it, you know, versus the day-to-day. I've made a variety of site visits and seen, you know, midday and seen two cars in the parking lot. You know, some of them already diagonally parked as, you know, the proposed new sites, you know, and then sometimes it's parallel parking. And then I think at sometimes you probably get parking from, what is it, 186? Like Dr. Nelly's building, I think. 174. I think occasionally people from the dentist office try to park up in there at times, but I think the signage is pretty clear as not to.
Right. It's you know, and this is another issue about the paving versus hard pack, which is you're getting people to change their parking behaviors to adopt those back three from parallel to angled. What you're saying is that they're already starting.
I think I did the Google Street View recently and it showed cars diagonally parked in there, you know, towards the back end of the proposed diagonal parking area.
Mr. Guy, do you live on the site or is this just a rental property?
Me?
Yeah.
No, Will and I are business partners. I'm here to be a second head.
He's Zachary Hunter. Okay. Not a great guy yet.
Oh, okay. Sorry. No. I was thinking you were at the... Okay. So the owner lives there, right?
He does not. Well, I guess he's
part-time.
Part-time. He'll be moving in tomorrow for the season.
Okay. Well, I think one consideration from the old zoning to the new zoning was that the old zoning used to have rules that said that you could not block in previous. Mm-hmm. That does not exist anymore under the new zoning. So that was one of the conditions that was left that pretty much said landlords and property managers can, it's not a city concern. If people are blocking themselves in, that's a landlord tenant management issue. If you can stack three cars in and tenants can manage who parks first, who parks second, who parks third so they can get out in the morning, that's up to them to figure out how they can do that.
Right, but I'm not understanding this to be that sort of stacked in.
Yeah, and that's one of the big differences. Previously, you couldn't block in previous cars, so it was very important in an application in November to demonstrate that each car had free access back to, no car could get blocked in. Each car would have to have free access back to the street. That requirement does not exist anymore, so it's important for circulation, but isn't a requirement for parking any longer.
Right.
You know, I think in one element of this and the reality of the, you know, there's the design that we've shown that there is adequate parking for each unit, but you know, Elm Street is full of meterless street side parking. You know, I know we'd considered potentially, you know, if we had to go for a waiver for one parking spot or something, that, you know, one of the guidelines I think in the regulations for that is that
access to alternatives.
Yeah, exactly. On street parking nearby. And there's plenty of that. So if my guess is that potentially the people who live in the two front units might just park on the street in front of their apartments and walk in the front door versus, you know, if this gets too crazy. But I think we've shown that it can work in theory.
Pleasure of the board. Any other questions about circulation?
I think the two new spots or the two new units have dedicated spots directly next to those units, so it doesn't really seem to me to affect the whatever's kind of existing there. I mean, as you say, you've demonstrated that you can add another space to meet the requirements of the regulations, but practically, the way I see this, the two new spaces that are the two new apartments that are going to go into the renovated carriage barn have their own new dedicated spaces right next to it, so I don't have any concerns.
I have a question.
Yes.
The turnaround is listed on the proposed site plan A04 as being 9 feet wide. Is that wide enough for a car to back around? I don't know what the average width of a car is.
Well, I think the placeholder for car parking, I think, is 9 by 20.
Parking.
Yeah.
For being still.
I mean, we can make that, I guess, bigger if need be. you know, I think it's not shown in detail, but, you know, in terms of the radius, mm-hmm. you know, per, like, the B71 standards.
If there's a foot to grab on the 182 side of that, and I know there's a building there, so there's a limit.
Yeah.
I think Kate's point is well taken, especially about maybe not necessarily the width, but it's the radius. I mean, that's a sharp corner to turn around.
Mm-hmm.
That's also your snow storage area.
Well, I think the snow storage, it's kind of a mix.
So that was snow storage next.
Okay, you're located behind it, though, to push through. Well, let's talk about snow storage. So you're proposing snow storage in that behind that little 9-foot turnaround?
Yeah, the setback. I mean, I guess.
Is that for the whole parking?
I don't think that would not be for the whole parking zone. I mean, I think currently it gets kind of packed up right in front of the, if you look at the existing site plan where that one parking spot on the floor is, basically it gets packed right there in front of the carriage barn. Oh, so right in front of your door, the majority of the main parking area.
It goes around the yard, right. And I don't think there's any way to really change that unless there's no parking.
And or it's snowblowed or...
Yeah, we'll never do that same kind of problem.
Yeah.
So in addition, I guess it would be true now that there's more alternatives, because more snow will be pushed back to
retain access, yeah.
Park.
Yeah.
So I imagine that the snow from the...
Yeah, so it seems like the new parking area could be split between, you know, behind the turnaround and then in front of where the two cars are parked.
Maybe a little difficult for the club and then get back there and back because of the way it goes down.
That could be the snowblower territory. But.
And, you know, the snow storage area in front of the cars, that doesn't look like particularly a great deal of snow storage space.
Yeah. Especially if we get a lot of snow.
I don't see how you're going to be able to change that radius on the turn. And is the I don't know what the average width of a snow plow is, if it's 9 feet or wider.
I think like on a pickup truck, I think it's smaller. Like, well, six to eight is what I would guess.
It's at least six.
Okay. I mean, I think that's your main snow storage area is back behind the old barn. And would there be an objection to having that listed as a snow storage thing? To ensure that 9-foot turnaround is not a parking area or misused as a condition of the permit, that it be labeled specifically a turnaround as a storage area. Because I think, you know, if anything, that's where it's going to have to, with this additional area, to push that snow back there. And it's going to have to go pretty far back in any given year.
Yeah.
Which may actually help in front of 182 to have less snow. Okay. Yes. So, we'd see that as an addition. So,
how many units are there right now again?
There's currently four.
So this would be adding an additional two.
Yep.
Next question, sort of moving through, is about bike racks, bike facilities, the sidewalks that are existing in front. You're not proposing any type of bike rack.
No, I mean,
building on the
interior stairs of some sort. Yeah, some hooks. I mean, and then there's also the whole other barn as well, which people are sort of using as storage kind of currently in addition to the...
Right. I mean, I think the reason why we have to review this is the idea that it's to encourage biking, mm-hmm. biking facilities. So, you know, while I don't necessarily want to have it, every project has to have a bike.
Yeah.
With six units located this close to downtown, I think it would make sense to have
yeah.
some sort of like walking facility.
I would call it secure bike parking, and that could be behind a locked door in the existing garage where people currently store things, or something snazzy underneath
the stairway.
Built into the stairwell or something.
Aesthetically
yep.
compatible with the views.
Yeah. I think currently
okay.
one of the tenants is a bike mechanic, and in the carriage barn that we're proposing to renovate, he's got a little area with like six bikes stacked away, so.
How long for one person?
I think so. So well, I guess we'll have to build him his own bike rack.
So then moving on to the next issue about the site landscaping, if you could just walk us through what you're proposing for the landscaping.
Well, basically, the majority of the landscaping, I think, we're going to try and concentrate around the sort of the new parking area. I think that the trees, you know, we're removing two trees, and then so I think to hit the zoning regulations for, I think it's 10 for however every 30 feet or something. But we'll be adding hopefully some more cedar trees, you know, as screening around the parking area. And then juniper bushes and lilacs. We don't, you know, don't have a landscape plan because this is the minor site plan. But I know that Mr. Guyette wants to do landscaping and, you know, to sort of see where we get to at the end, you know, and just be like, it's an important part for him. We haven't drawn where the juniper shrubs or the lilacs will go, but there's already some existing lilacs kind of at the corner of the driveway along the property line there. It's existing, a little too mature. I think maples in the front yard, so.
Okay, I understand it's a minor site plan, but at the same time, a little bit hard to approve a cluster of lilacs here.
Yeah, I mean, I guess.
I mean, I'm looking at, so there are two trees along the shed that have to be removed.
Yeah, basically for the parking area.
Right. I suspect, given how close they are to the shed, they weren't necessarily planted.
They're basically dead.
And they look, when trees that close to a building, usually are volunteer.
Yeah.
So, I mean, and not that we have to approve every taking down of a tree, but the discussion earlier about having cedars along, because my big concern, it doesn't look like you're not touching the trees in front of Elm Street,
nope.
Nor are you touching the shrubbery, you know, along the side of the driveway.
Sort of courtyard area.
Courtyard. You know, you're expanding into the yard, you're building this driveway, you're knocking down the shed, taking down those two trees. So really, that's the main area. You're going to put some type of landscaping, a shrubbery, in front of the entrance and exit.
Mm-hmm.
For aesthetic reasons, you're going to line the driveway, it sounds like, with shrubs,
mm-hmm.
And would you accept a condition that the plants that you pick from the non-invasive
yeah.
List, and that you maintain any plantings?
Yeah.
And then I think the really important planting is obviously across from the driveway to 182.
The screenings.
And put in cedars or similar type of evergreens that are going to augment the U block that exists, or to the extent that there, some of those branches have to be cut back and there's dead areas, that you create that visual screen to maintain, so that when cars come in, because I'm thinking in winter, you know, if a car comes in, backs into the spot, their lights are going to go right on 182.
Yeah.
You want some sort of evergreen.
Yeah. Yeah.
It just seems like it's pretty tight there. Like,
yeah.
The cars are going to get in. I don't quite understand how they're going to, or also the trees that have to go through.
Yeah. Essentially probably be right on the property line.
Right. I mean, Ms. Hunter, I'm really thinking about, like, right here in this portion of the house. I'm looking at the A2.
Oh, A2 existing?
Existing, but actually we could probably go to
A4.
A4 that would have the proposed.
Yeah. It does seem a little crunchy back there, the distance off the corner of the, where the two new units will be to the property lines, only 12 feet.
Yeah, she made us some ideas. Oh, Sarah, she didn't like that.
Yep.
Yeah.
I would be hesitant to make a condition that isn't going to work from a physical standpoint.
Yeah, no, that's why I'm just sort of talking through before.
Right, I understand that, but it sounds like you would like to put some plantings there.
It's our goal. I mean, that's part of the design, is to have privacy screen plantings.
I mean, my big concern is if you look at A4, mm-hmm. where the two cars are facing in,
yep.
if they back in, or you know, even if they're rear lights, that's a pretty close proximity to 182, and if there are windows along this section here,
yeah,
because we can't control when cars come in. If somebody comes back from a very long road trip at 3 a.m. and flashes the lights as they back in, even if it's just for a short period of time, I mean, there should be some mitigation, mm-hmm. screening for that.
Yeah, I think.
I agree with Kevin that you can't, if the plantings won't work, they won't work.
Have we determined that the existing yews, you said it was yew tree?
It's a yew, but that only goes to the end of the porch. It's basically the front yard.
Okay, so we've determined that that's insufficient given the new configuration.
They're thinking about maybe more trees. I just don't know. Maybe they would fit. Good idea to maybe consult with Sarah Hoffman.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, maybe they would fit if they were very tall and thin trees or something.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
And that additional screening would be desirable from your perspective.
I think that's part of our plan. It's just hard to depict on, you know, small paper and have, you know, here's the species. And, you know, it's starting to get busy in there.
So
that area is maybe merits
it's a busy
area.
Yeah.
And it would be good to see and understand that on a larger scale.
Yeah, there's not much space in there.
Yeah.
Obviously want a condition too, then, with any of these plantings, that they be maintained, they die, they're replaced on a regular basis.
Yeah. I think it's definitely an important element of the design, for sure.
And then the outdoor lighting, how many units of outdoor lighting, or how many outdoor lighting?
I'm just planning for two. Sort of to illuminate the stairs and the doors. They're shielded downlights.
Downcast.
Yeah.
And that's the whack lighting on the back there.
Yeah. Yeah, they'd be, I think they would potentially be next to each door, so they would illuminate the entrance as well as the stairs.
The 11.5 watts that's specified for those lights, right? What's that equivalent to in incandescent?
That's a good question.
I would guess 75, yeah.
Yeah.
I think a 9 is 40 generally, so I would think an OR.
Well, that's pretty close.
Would be getting up to 60 or 75. Yeah.
It's not 300.
Yeah, it's not a spotlight. It's not a mercury halide, you know.
Yeah, and when you put it in a lamp that directs it down.
we'll get used to these new measurements.
Yeah, right, yeah, the lumens are the magic number.
Yes, that's right.
It's 1,200 lumens, it says, but I don't know if that anymore.
It's the 10,000s, or 100,000s. Staff comment about the fact that the lamps were not Energy Star.
There's a requirement that they be Energy Star, but it's an LED light, and so I'm it's in the zoning, and when I do the revision to the zoning, I'm gonna contact and find out, you know, if we just have a requirement for LED rather than going having a require for Energy Star rating, because I think Energy Star is an independent.
To know whether LED is always automatically Energy Star or whether Energy Star adds some other value.
Yeah, if it doesn't add any value, really what we care about is the energy. So.
Well, there may be some value. I'm speculating here, but there may be some value in color correction with Energy Star. I mean, rather than the unrated, because I've seen the two of them side by side. Energy Star is a little more expensive. Maybe, I don't know.
I think it really applies a lot of times if you're going for a rating for your whole project, you know, LEED or Energy Star.
And Energy Star is the standard.
Yeah.
But I do know with LED lights, color correction is important, because you can have some pretty glaring looking LED lighting.
Yeah, we'll have to do some additional homework on that. But right now the requirements say it's supposed to be Energy Star rated lamps only. So
we need evidence for that. Do you have evidence?
We can provide that.
Okay.
I'm just a fairly energy efficient lamp. If it was Energy Star rated, we could, you know, either find a very similar lamp that is Energy Star rated if this one is not.
I will say WAC lighting's a pretty large residential producer of lighting. You know, it's not some knockoff we found on Amazon or something like that. It's a good quality light, so I wouldn't be surprised if it was rated.
Get that.
I may have just missed that in the regulations and failed to screenshot that part of the light cut sheet.
Okay, and that's something you think you can just supplement? But,
yeah.
I mean, I don't feel like we need to review that beyond
another hearing for that.
Yeah, no additional hearing for that. Okay, I mean, I think those were the main issues on the site plan. Did anyone else have any other questions or concerns?
I had one other on page 11 that I think should be somewhat, it's at the bottom, and it's about the fact that under the rules, aisles shall be 20 feet wide, and the proposal here is to be 12 feet. And so I kind of wrote out some things. DPW director was comfortable stating the use is existing, and the addition of two vehicles will not pose significant risk of obstructed access. Obstructed vehicles can turn into the turnaround to allow for other vehicles to park and then give them clear path to egress. Staff finds that given the physical characteristics of the lot being long and narrow and existing development, the houses close together using a shared driveway, the only possible way to widen the driveway would be to remove landscaping and fencing in the front yard and pave closer to the house. Weighing the inconvenience of backing into the turnaround to let someone access the parking compared to the loss of landscaping to widen the driveway, staff would keep the non-conforming driveway narrow as the better option in this case, but that's certainly your call.
call to make.
I think the testimony earlier was that the configuration, while crowded, does seem to work, and that there weren't people getting stuck in the driveway as it exists. In the addition of, really, we're talking about one car, because there's, we're losing a space and we're gaining a two spaces, so net one car difference. I don't see, I mean, it's, I suspect anyone coming to visit has confusion, but anyone who lives there quickly learns the way of the world or the way of the driveway. Is that accurate, Ms. Hunter? Okay.
I saw your husband pulling out forwards the other day, so he hasn't figured out quite well.
He tried to go out a little
bit. Yeah.
He said that's not a good approach.
Yeah, for sure.
But although the people that are parked parallel, now there are two people parked parallel, there would be 3 days.
Yeah.
Do we have a preference? Keeping it 12 or 20 or questions about that?
I think staff's analysis is
right. I would defer, definitely defer to
DPW,
staff,
yeah.
And DPW in particular on this.
I don't have them. Okay, so let's go through conditional use. I think the last area. Straightforward. So 3302 talks about capacity of community facilities and utilities. It says the applicant shall demonstrate that the proposed development shall not cause a disproportionate unreasonable burden on the city's ability to provide community facilities and utilities, including one local schools, police and fire, ambulance, street infrastructure and maintenance, parks and recreation facilities, water supply, sewage disposal, stormwater systems and infrastructure. It's pretty self-evident that none of this is going to be impacted by adding two residential units in an already residential area. But the impacts are really internal to the site, not to the community facilities. So the next one is traffic. Applicant shall demonstrate that the proposed development will not have an undue adverse effect upon the traffic in the area, including the volume, type, and timing. The traffic generated by the proposed development shall not unreasonably and disproportionately reduce the level of service, that reasonable measures have been taken to mitigate or minimize the amount of vehicular traffic generated for proposed development. We're talking about a net one car on an otherwise major street, Vermont State Route 12 at that point. Unlikely this one or two traffic trip per day is going to impact how the traffic flows. And this is fairly close to the new intersection, too,
yeah,
the stop signs.
Which is, I think, beneficial for this property, for sure.
Right. It probably makes coming in and out of your driveway a little bit easier these days. Okay. Character of the neighborhood, neighborhood standards. Applicant shall demonstrate that the proposed development shall not have an undue adverse effect upon the character of the neighborhood. And this neighborhood is a mixed-use residential district, including the Meadow, which has historic homes close to the sidewalk, tree-lined streets. Large homes have been converted to multifamily buildings. The neighborhood continues to have historic appeal. I think that's part of what your testimony was, that this preserves some of the historic appeal by keeping the carriage barn functional in improving it. Regulations are intended to protect the residential scale and character of the neighborhood created by primarily residential use, historic building stock, front yards, porches, walkable tree-lined streets. So I think that, if anything, that the proposal to have some sort of bike facility built into this, safe bike storage, what is that phrase?
Secure.
Secure bike storage space is important for that. And architectural compatibility, you're restoring an existing carriage barn. The demolition of the shed is, if anything, going to improve that structure. Yards, lot coverage, and landscaping. The new development shall maintain a sense of open space If not, I'll wait for Kevin to come back.
I have a question in the meantime.
Yeah.
We had a good and I think important discussion about that area where the two new parking spaces are going in, about screening for the neighbor's home, about the 9-foot area that will be partially used for storage but also very important for turning around. Do we feel we've collected enough detail on that, or are we satisfied with assurances that it could be more than 9 feet, that landscaping will be worked out, that the turning radius will be good?
Well, I think
I kind of wonder where we landed. That's where there were the most questions about the long-term function of the site and compatibility between properties for me, and I wonder what we need to do there.
So at least on the screening, I'm comfortable with representations of the planting and screening, because there's a neighbor and the applicant who are here, or the applicant's representatives, that are seeming to work it out and understanding what the issues are. And I think we've raised them. I mean, we've proposed, this kind of reminds me of the Sherwood Drive application, where, you know, the initial proposal was for a live vegetative screening wall, and when that proved unfeasible or not satisfied concerns, the neighbors raised these issues, and you know, they came back and revised the application for a different type of, I mean, I think they had to, for some reason, they had to get additional permitting, but they sought out fencing instead. That proved to be the more effective screen.
Yeah, I think my understanding, and I think I can back this up, is that the initial sort of, you know, back last fall, the sort of sketch plan review was that the Guyettes as well as the Hunters kind of, you know, you worked out, you know, that there was some other parking arrangement alternatives that sort of took away all the courtyard space and made it the main parking area more congested. You all sort of agreed that this was...
It made sense to not take out the grounds and courtyard.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, exactly. So I think, you know, obviously the pattern of neighborly communication and this is set, and it's important to maintain.
I think it would be a good idea, as you mentioned, Sarah, maybe we could do a consultation with her.
For sure.
And see what she would suggest.
Yeah.
Because I have spoken with her about that.
Yeah, I was speaking with Alex actually at one point about.
Yes.
And they actually used to live.
And they did, yeah. That's,
building.
Yeah.
So is it the board's responsibility to provide any sort of protection for the neighbor when it comes to screening? Or is it sufficient to trust the continued neighborly interaction? Again, I'm thinking of sort of long-term circumstances when different people may live in these places. And it is an honest question about what is typical in a situation like this. It's pretty close quarters. I want to do it right.
Well, Kevin, I mean, I was giving my opinion. I was bringing up the Sherwood Drive, the Family Center example, where we approved at one point what they had proposed of a live vegetative screening that proved ineffective.
Proved ineffective, and then they moved to a fencing solution.
And came back.
Right.
And, you know, I think what we can do, and maybe this is the best way to protect, is that, and this is why I raised this particular, is that the proposed vegetative screening shall provide, and just make this a condition, shall provide an effective visual barrier between the proposed new parking area and 182. That way, if it doesn't, you know, it becomes an issue of the permit, and it does give the neighbor some, you know, if they can work it out informally, great. But then if the neighbor is unsatisfied, it can reopen.
I wonder if that isn't delving a little too far into into the weeds from the standpoint of what our real responsibilities are.
Well, I think it falls under conditional use only because...
Yeah, I get that, but trying to project what the future is going to hold is, I mean...
I understand.
You know, we all play that game.
Well, sure, and it's easy to imagine these two people getting along as opposed to the successors who are going to despise each other.
Venom,
you know?
Might be
blowing.
Yeah, for sure.
And that's the thing about a permit, is it does try to anticipate the future. based on what we're allowing today.
I guess I'm inclined to think of some condition that would, you know,
give some ability to come back.
What you just said satisfies my concern, and I think codifies what I'm hearing anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, because in terms of, like, even the resale value of the house, if new prospective purchasers were worried about something, you know, maybe they're worried because it's so close and the lights and they can see them, you know, it would be good to have something to,
yeah,
to say yes and renegotiate. I don't know. That's probably the sticking point of the project.
I mean, and ultimately, I think, you know, because of this, and part of it may be in practice, too, and part of this is trying to predict, and that's at least the family center issue, is trying to predict. They proposed one solution. When it didn't work, they came back and proposed another, and we haven't heard from them since, so they must all be very happy. Okay. So, what's the pleasure of the board? I think we've gone through, Kevin, we went through the conditional use and the no issues. So there's essentially three approvals that we have to give: the minor site plan and review, the conditional use, and the demolition of a contributing structure. I know there are certain conditions that we have talked about through here, some of which are also staff. If you look on page 20 and 21, there's about six staff recommendations. Most are just standard. The erosion control the applicant shall follow the erosion control practices outlined in section 3008D. Second is the applicant shall manage all stormwater on site and not direct flow downward down the driveway toward the street or adversely impact neighboring properties. Three, the applicant shall record a revised right-of-way and driveway use agreement within 30 days of the DRB decision, and prior to the issuance of a zoning permit, the revised agreement will reflect in number four of the agreement that the area will be used for the parking of six automobiles, and that the 18486 shall have access to one diagonal and three parallel parking spaces near Elm Street, which is, I think, what you're proposing. The applicant shall not obstruct the use of land that's designated as turnaround and snow storage, which we talked about before. Five, that landscaping shall be maintained in a healthy condition. Dead or dying plants shall be replaced within one growing season with a bearable plant in terms of type, form, size, and maturity, etc., or of at least minimum size requirements specified in Figure 320. Six, any future enlargement, alteration, or change of use will require a permit from the City of Montpelier. And then we had talked about possibly two more. One was to incorporate a secure bike storage area. And the other is the visual screening.
Yeah.
In front of the proposed new parking area.
Sort of tied into number five there.
Correct. Did we want to add a number for number seven, provide secure bike storage for a minimum of so many bikes, or is it just as long as there's bike storage for at least? Yeah. At least one bike. At least one bike.
One
all right.
Per unit.
I provide secure bike storage, period.
I have a opinion about that as long as there's something.
Yeah.
Okay.
Any of those conditions cause you heartburn, problem, upset stomach?
No.
Okay. What's the pleasure of the board? We can vote on these all at once, or we can break them down into all three, but they should probably incorporate the conditions.
I think that, I don't know, just a thought, it makes sense to approve separately.
I think you're right.
Because conditional use, we're going to want to add the conditions, and I think it'd be cleaner. So I would propose that we do that.
Okay.
And if we're in agreement, I will make a proposal to approve the site plan approval with, where did we end up with the screening?
I think we had proposed to have the, visual screening, so screening plantings between the proposed new driveway, new parking area, and 182 Elm Street.
If feasible?
If feasible. Well, I think we were going a little beyond that to just requiring some type of screening, because Will was...
Okay, some type of screening. So you start with the plan, that doesn't work, you...
Exactly.
Okay. I propose acceptance of site plan approval with the conditions of screening between 182 and 184 as detailed by the board.
Okay. So motion by Kevin.
Seconded.
Seconded by Ryan. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. All right. So does someone want to take up, let's go with the demolition next?
Sure, I'll move that we approve the demolition of the contributing historic structure as presented in the application.
Motion by Ryan, second by Kate. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. And it is approved. So that brings us down to conditional use.
I'll move that we approve the conditional use application as presented with the conditions that were already set out. Do you want to restate them? Or?
One through seven.
The additional conditions 1 through 7 that were discussed prior.
Okay. Is that sufficiently?
I think it is, because you're going to write this up.
You're
going to
write this anyway.
You already read them.
Okay.
So I would second
motion by Ryan, second by Kevin. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. We do have approval. So we'll write these up, these conditions, in case you didn't take notes. Issue a decision with those conditions incorporated into it. But that's all we need for tonight. Anything else we can do for you?
I guess my one question is the conditions of approval for the driveway use agreement, 30 days of this decision prior to the issuance of the zoning permit?
Yes.
So once that agreement is submitted, recorded, then we'll get the zoning permit?
Yes. Gotcha. So it's the one thing we can hold over to get to make sure that you...
And then all the other conditions are, once we have our zoning permit, we put up our safe fence.
Exactly, and that stops that. Yeah, it just stops from someone from going forward without the full
proper agreement. Yeah,
right.
Good.
Good. All right.
Thank you
all very much. All right. The only other business is our next regularly scheduled meeting is for Monday, June 4th, on 2018 at 7 p.m. Otherwise, I will take it, unless there's any other new business.
Do we? Meredith, do you remember, do we have a DRB meeting on the 4th?
I don't think we have anything for a DRB meeting.
We will.
Because this all happened.
Yeah, stay it sounds like posted, because I think
the
sketch plan,
Mr.
two lot subdivision.
He won't be in. He'll be in the next meeting after that, because it takes 15 days to warn that meeting. So it's 14 days away. So I was pretty sure unless there was a continuous, Audra told me, unless we continued an application, there will not be a DRB meeting for the 4th.
Okay.
So
anyway.
Puts us to the 18th. It would put us to the 18th. Okay. Well, nevertheless, if something should emerge, unlikely as it is, I'll take a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Motion by Kevin.
Second.
Second by Kate. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. We are adjourned.